The Atari VCS is more than just a console, it's also a fairly capable computer despite what people will tell you. Out of the box, the Atari VCS will contain 4 to 8 gigabytes of RAM depending on your model. All the Indiegogo backers received 8 gigs in their units, but a 4 gig variant is available for pre-order at Walmart. If you don't know how much RAM you have, take a look at the box. If it says 400, then you have 4 gigs, and 8 gigs if it says 800. Now, a lot of people will tell you that 8 gigs is plenty, and for the most part they're right, but if you do want to add more RAM to increase the performance of your VCS, you can upgrade the internal RAM up to 32 gigs. But the real drawback of the Atari VCS is its internal storage out of the box. It comes with 32 gigs, which is fine for basic stuff, but if you really want to take full advantage of the VCS, you need to upgrade the storage. You can plug in a flash drive of your choosing and format it specifically for the VCS, but if you want a more permanent solution and not take up one of your 4 precious USB 3.1 ports, you're going to want to install an SSD. This video will help you do this. And before we begin, a quick disclaimer, the Atari VCS is taken apart very specifically, and if you rush, you will damage your Atari VCS, possibly beyond repair. So I take no responsibility if you bork this up. But if you take your time, you'll be able to upgrade the RAM and SSD in about 30 to 40 minutes. Also, at the end of this video, I've put my experience for installing an OS. It's not a complete guide because I'm not an expert, but I'll leave a guide on how to put Ubuntu on this thing with no issues. But with that out of the way, here's what you'll need to get started. A towel or soft surface to lay your VCS on because you don't want to get it scratched. A Torx 10 screwdriver, mine was 9, but it'll fit just fine. DDR-SO DIMM memory for small form factor PCs or laptops. Now this is important because if you get regular size RAM, it won't fit. I got the G-Skill Ripjaws 2666MHz RAM. I got 32 gigs, which is the max the Atari VCS will support. And also, as you'll see in a bit, I don't want to take this thing apart ever again, so I might as well just max it out now. The SSD must be an M.2 SATA, not NVMe, and you can tell the difference by the amount of slots it has and also it's on the box. The SATA has 2 slots where the NVMe just has 1. NVMe's are the most popular right now, so make sure you get the right one. I chose 500 gigs because it was only $50 and I had a gift card. You'll also need an M.2 installation kit to mount the SSD to the motherboard or an appropriate screw if you have one. I'll leave a link in the description and pinned comment if you want to buy these parts to remove the guesswork of whether or not your desired RAM is compatible. You'll also want a spudger made out of plastic, and you can get these like from the iFixit store or just any type of plastic thing to help pry off some of the parts so that you don't ruin the plastic. You can also use your fingers, but having a spudger gives you a little bit more leverage. And this is optional, but a plastic tray for keeping all of your screws in one place, because if you lose one, well, you're screwed. You have all your stuff, let's take apart the Atari VCS. Now again, I really want to stress that you have to be mindful when doing this, because there are 2 wires at the top of the VCS that run from the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth chip, and if you open it up the wrong way, you'll pop these wires loose or potentially tear them off, and it'll be a royal pain to get them back together. I actually popped mine off and was able to reattach them, but you might not be so lucky. Don't make the mistake that I did and be careful and take your time. The first thing you'll want to do is flip over the Atari VCS with the front panel facing away from you and take out the 4 plugs at the bottom of the console. Now you can remove these feet completely, but I find just pulling the plug part and leaving the rest stuck works just as well. They do say that the glue is fine enough to be re-adhered, but why chance it? Once you take these screws out, now you can pry off the front panel, and this is where that spudger comes in. I found that flipping the system back right side up and prying it from the top worked a ton better than working from the upside down. I started from one side, then worked my way across, and then the panel came right off. Now what you need to do, now that the front panel is off, you want to take off the back panel, which comes off the same way, which was actually missing from the guide that I used from Atari. Now that you have both of these panels off, and you remember we talked about those wires, with the system right side up and back facing you, lift up the back side of the VCS and slowly bring the panel up so it flips forward like a book. That way you won't detach the wires, and you can see them up in the top right of this board. Now, I suggest removing this wireless module when upgrading the RAM. It's not necessary, but it makes things a lot easier. But if all you wanted to do was install an SSD, you can skip to this time code. But if you want to install the RAM as well, let's keep taking this thing apart. Removing the wireless module allows you to put the top away so that you can focus on the rest of the console. Now, there are 6 screws for you to take off. Just note that there is one under the diffuser here. You don't need to remove the diffuser, just nudge it out of the way to find the screw that really needs to be removed. Once you've removed all of those screws, you just need to disconnect the USB ribbon cables. You take the spudger and then move the bracket forward to unlock the ribbon on each side. Once those are removed, you can take the motherboard out and flip it over to find the RAM. If the heat shield comes with it, you can just easily peel it off. So, like I said, you do need small form factor or laptop RAM. And in order to remove the current RAM, you just need to unclip the top stick of RAM, which causes the piece to spring up. So you remove that top stick and then do the same with the bottom stick. And there's 2 clips that you have to be mindful of on both sides. Once that's done, all you need to do is install the new RAM, which is pretty simple. Just put the RAM in the way that it fits. RAM has been made dummy-proof nowadays, so it only fits a specific way. In my case, it looked like I was installing it upside down. Install the bottom stick first by inserting it into the slot and then pressing down until you hear a click, and then the second stick on top using that same method. So congratulations, you've installed your RAM. Now it's time to start putting the VCS back together. First by making sure that the heat shield is back on the bottom. Then once the board is seated, put your USB cables back in, pulling down the gate to make sure that the cable stays in place. Then put those 6 screws back in place, and now it's time to install the SSD. I guess you could have installed the SSD before the RAM, but I didn't really want to mess with anything. The SSD installation is way simpler than the RAM because all you need to do is put it in the empty slot. One thing that you will need to do is screw the SSD down, and that's where the M.2 kit comes in handy. And now, don't forget to put the wireless chip back where you found it. Once you've installed the SSD, you can now put the Atari VCS finally back together, making sure not to pull those wireless wires out of place. And once the top is fitted nice, you can put the front and back panels on, making sure that they clip into place. And now after that, you just need to put the bottom 4 screws back in and the feet over those screws. And if you did everything correctly, you should be able to turn on the system with no issues. You won't be able to see the available RAM in the Atari VCS OS, but you will be able to see the SSD. It should show up as an unformatted drive with the option to format. So now if you don't want to install an alternative OS, you can just format the drive and use that as additional storage, and then you're done. However, if you do want to see my experience of how I installed a separate OS, continue watching. The VCS does support a third-party OS, however, at the time of the video, the Atari VCS only has guides on how to install Ubuntu, Windows 10, or Debian. Windows 10 is what most people are familiar with, so if you have a key, you can install that. Also, I guess Windows 10 Home comes with a 30-day free trial or something because I was able to install that with no issues. But if you're cheap like me and want a challenge, then you can install Linux. Any distro that has a secure boot will work, but I went with Ubuntu just because I'm very green when it comes to Linux. And I don't want to start a fight in the comments about which Linux fork is best, but if there's a gaming-centric one for ROMs and stuff, let me know in the comments below. Outside of that, you're limited on what OS you use because of the secure boot that Atari uses. Any OS without one isn't going to be able to load, and you'll get an error that says the UEFI bootloader is protected. So Gamer OS won't be able to be used, at least right now out of the box. So like I said in the top of the video, I'm not going to go too in depth on how to install an OS because one, there's a ton of instruction manuals listed elsewhere. And also I'm kind of the last person you want to seek software installation advice from, but I will give a rundown of what problems I ran into. So that way, if you run into them, it'll be easier for you to troubleshoot them. You do need to create a bootable USB drive with the OS of your choice, and I suggest using a USB 3.1 stick so that way you can run the OS off of that drive quickly, and a keyboard. You can't install any other OS with just the controller. So once that's created, what you need to do is from a cold boot, boot up your Atari VCS and then repeatedly hit the escape key to enter the BIOS and choose the boot device. If you need to boot from the USB, select that and then your Atari VCS will boot that OS, prompting you to install. Afterwards, you can just select whatever OS is on the drive. So I installed two OSs, Ubuntu and Windows 10, since I'm a royal noob at Linux, and it's been actually 20 years since I've touched it. I installed Ubuntu first and then split the SSD in half, so 256 gigs for Linux and then 256 gigs for Windows, and actually the 256 gig Linux partition will be readable by the Atari VCS, but not the Windows partition. Now you don't have to split the SSD, but I did it because I do plan on installing Windows 10 onto the free partition, but I'll go into what problems I ran into in a bit. Ubuntu is really easy to install. Just tell it where you want to put it. Just keep in mind that you do need to set the drive mapper to /, otherwise it'll keep yelling at you and you'd have to Google what the solution was. So you finished installing Ubuntu, and one thing that you'll realize is that the Wi-Fi is kind of borked, and that's because you need to turn off the Wi-Fi power saving measures. For whatever reason, the Wi-Fi device in here will go into power saving mode by default, meaning that your Wi-Fi will keep going out, then restarting, making it useless to connect to the internet. So I'll leave a link to the code that I use in the description below, but after that, you're all set to use Ubuntu. I installed Steam and booted up some Genesis collection and it looked all wonky though. And according to Discord, you do need to update Mesa, and I'm trying to figure out how to make it work because it says that it's not available.
Editor Nick here, just to chime in, I did fix the issue. Well, actually it fixed by itself. It turns out as I was trying to capture footage of the Genesis acting all wonky, it updated the drivers automatically and now it works just fine. Well, the Genesis collection does kind of work a little bit weird, and I think it's more to do that it's running on Linux than it actually the Atari VCS having trouble running it.
The other OS that I installed was Windows 10 Home. Now, this one doesn't install the same way that Linux does. Normally, you would make a Windows bootable USB drive, but if you do that, the install won't complete on the Atari VCS. Instead, you'll need to use Win to USB to create an install on a flash drive, and then it will get to the point where you can continue to install Windows on the Atari VCS. Basically, you're creating a virtual hard disk. Once you have the virtual hard disk, you just have to plug in the flash drive to the VCS and power on the system, and Windows will do the rest. From start to finish, it takes about 30 minutes to get everything all set. Just keep in mind that this process will install Windows on your selected flash drive, not the installed SSD. I tried to clone the flash drive to the SSD partition, but I didn't have any luck. And according to the Discord, if you take the SSD out of the system and then put it into a USB enclosure, you can tell Win to USB to put it on that. And so that way you can just put the SSD back into the VCS and then you have Windows on that partition. And also to note, if you do choose to keep it on the flash drive, if you leave the flash drive in the VCS will always boot to Windows by default each time, unless you change the boot order or just remove the flash drive with the power off. So that wraps up this video on installing RAM and an SSD and an overlook on how to install OSs. And it's another long video, man, and I'm glad that you made it this far. And if you did, and you found it useful, please give it a like and share it with anyone who might find it interesting. And if you have any questions that you run into, please leave them below and I'll do my best to answer them. If you are new here, check out my other Atari VCS videos in the playlist corner. Or if you're not interested in VCS content or you want to see what else I'm up to, check out the other videos on my channel. And if you like what you see, consider subscribing for future content. You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Snicktendo. Thanks so much for watching.